Hello again, I'm Bob Colt, and we're continuing our conversations in Charlotte Public Schools. Bill Blair and wrestling in Charlotte. You've got the Orioles shirt and wrestling.
Yeah, came prepared.
Tell us about the wrestling program in Charlotte.
This is my 10th year. This will be my 10th year running it. We're constantly improving, it seems like. I think last year we were 23-10 overall. We had one kid place third in the state. We've had quite a few kids place All-State in the 10 years I've been here. Some as high as second and third. The kid last year was third in the state, and he'll be back again this year. He's a junior.
And what does it take to be a good wrestler?
It takes a lot of training, commitment for 3 months. I don't demand the kids come in over the summer with me, and I give them a life outside of that. But most of them play in football, and they're busy with that. A lot of them do track and baseball. But for 3 months, they're committed. They're here pretty much 6 days a week with our county tournament, and they go hard for 2 hours a day, and it's a grueling sport.
It is a grueling sport. It's a difficult thing to do, but it teaches young people a lot of values, doesn't it?
Yeah, definitely. It teaches, just in your body alone, maintaining your body weight, watching what you eat if you have to. Obviously, the work ethic comes with the practice. It's not an easy sport, and you have to be in shape with it.
And Bill, you've been here for 10 years, but probably a long history and involvement in the sport. And you mentioned weight. That's always been a big issue in the sport, and whether or not it's really healthy for young people. And that whole conversation has changed dramatically over time, hasn't it?
It has. When I was in high school, this was 15 years ago, or more than that, actually. It just came out then. They called it Alpha Weigh-In. I was like my freshman year, we were guinea pigs for it. They do your body assessment, they take your body fat, and they kind of just calculate out what's a healthy body weight, the lowest healthy body weight this individual can be. And since then, it's gotten huge. It's monitored closely, it's all online now. You pull a kid up from a different school and see what their lowest body fat is to be healthy. They can't go below 7% body fat. So they monitor it very closely. A wrestler can't go out and just lose 15 pounds to say, I'm going to lose 15 pounds because I want to wrestle this lowest weight class. Those days are kind of gone by now.
They are, and it had been kind of crazy for young people to cut a lot of weight, but it had been pretty typical, mm-hmm. wasn't it? In the sport and older, in
older generations.
And older generations.
Up at the mid-90s, really.
Yeah. And so what forced the change?
Just knowledge, really. We know that starving yourself is not the best way to lose weight, and that going to 3% body fat is not good for you in the long run. It affects your kidneys, affects your body overall.
Yeah.
Affects your metabolism when you're an older individual.
It's a much healthier sport now,
isn't
it? It
is, yeah.
And so what do you do to make sure that young people are healthy?
Well, we have a nutrition meeting we have one next week, a nutrition meeting with our nutritionist here at the school. They talk about things that you should eat before practice, after practice, how much water you should consume per pound that you sweat off. They really focus on hydration a lot, and they focus on maintaining the correct balance of carbs and proteins and fats and all that.
Yeah.
I really try not to have kids starve themselves. If a kid may miss a lunch, then I feel bad about that. But I really don't have kids that going out starving themselves. When I say they watch what they eat, maybe they're losing 2 or 3 pounds, and some kids can stand to lose 3 or 4 pounds.
Yeah. Coaches didn't used to care about those things, did they?
Yeah, but I think that, again, that comes along with knowledge. Things have changed.
Yeah. And so as individuals come in and they wrestle in a weight class, and that's sort of how we've categorized it, how do you make a good team?
It's tough. Like right now, for example, I have a team's composed of 14, made up of 14 wrestlers. So out of my 25 or 30 that I'll have this year, probably 10 are all around 130 pounds, and they're all good wrestlers.
Yeah.
Where if they could somehow spread out, if I had a magic wand, we'd be a very good team.
Yeah.
Where now, if I have 10 guys at one weight class, really, I'm stuck trying to fill spots here and there, and it's tough. That's a challenge that every coach faces. We can't control what our kids weigh.
Yeah.
Kids are going to grow naturally, and that's just how it works.
Has Charlotte had more success with younger weight class or lighter weight classes and younger people than heavier weight classes and older students?
It really changes a lot. The last couple of years, our heavier weights seem to be the anchor of the team, and this year, like I said, our from 112 to 135 are really strong. And again, back to that 130 spot where I have a whole bunch of individuals. I mean, we still have some solid upper weights too, but it seems to change every couple of years. It kind of, there's a little change in the guard.
Wrestling's kind of a family tradition for
it is, yeah.
In a community. Dude, talk about that.
I've had several siblings go through. I've had their older brother and then their younger brother. And a lot of times their parent or their dad wrestled either for Charlotte or for a school nearby, it seemed like. So, and their grandpa would wrestle, and yeah, a lot of, and the same thing at our tournaments and home meets. We get a lot of past wrestlers from the 70s and 80s that come, and sometimes their grandkids are even wrestling now.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's a great tradition. And what is it that you think is attractive to people with the sport of wrestling?
I think it's just the one-on-one competition of it. There's no one you can really blame. If you're in some sports, if your team loses, you can say, well, my teammate kind of screwed this up. Well, in wrestling, it's one-on-one, and either you win or you lost.
Is wrestling a sport where you think it's really knowledge-based as much as it is physically?
There's a lot of both. I mean, you can be a very physical person with a little knowledge and do okay, or vice versa. A lot of it is really the mental aspect behind it all. So you have a lot of knowledge of the sport and just not be, like we use the word, mentally tough. Or same thing with the physical part. You could maybe be able to bench press 300 pounds, but you may not be able to move someone on a wrestling mat. So there's a lot of components involved with wrestling.
So, Bill, when a student comes in Charlotte and they're part of the wrestling program, and a lot of people might not be as familiar with it as you or maybe some parents, what's a practice like? How do you prepare?
We spend, typically a practice for us is anywhere from an hour and a half to 2 hours. Usually 5 o'clock is my deadline. After five, we're done, no matter what it seems like. But typically we come in and we roll around. I say roll around, like we do somersaults and we tumble around a little bit. Just to, one, it helps with balance overall, and it actually gets the kids loose. It loosens up their backs and their necks and their shoulders. Then we stretch for 5 or 10 minutes. That's kind of our joking around period. We kind of tell stories and stretch as a team. And then we spend a good half hour just going over technique stuff. Moderate speed, building up speed as that half hour builds on. So by the end of that half hour, we're really ready for 1 hour of really hard wrestling. Whether it's running and sprinting and push-ups, or if it's actually hand-to-hand wrestling.
So it's as much practice in the moves of the sport as it might be in conditioning and other things.
Yeah, you have to, definitely have to practice the moves.
Yeah.
You have to have technique.
And so do you take, you know, maybe a dozen moves that you make sure that the team is proficient in and goes into, individual members go into a match with?
I do. I really am a firm believer of keep it simple. My kids probably get bored with it because we've been doing the same moves for, if they're seniors, they've been doing the same 15 moves for 4 years now, and they're probably doing them in their sleep, I'm sure. But when they're freshmen and they come in, they're still, I mean, they have a hard time grasping them, and their technique's not there. By the time they're seniors, they can teach the freshmen how to do them, and they're, like I said, they can do them in their sleep. They've done them so many times.
And that's what practice is all about.
Yeah.
You do it
over
as many
times. Over,
over and over again so that you become proficient, so that when you're actually in the competition, it's kind of a natural thing. And so talk about the competition then. What do you look for in the upcoming year in Charlotte?
I think we're going to be a competitive team. We had one senior last year. And we were a good team last year. We were close to the top of our conference. We were close to winning a district. We lost both of those pretty much by a match. We had one senior leave who was a good wrestler. He only had 3 losses on the year. But we have everybody else coming back up, plus a couple other freshmen that should be able to contribute. So I'm looking for a pretty solid team as far as our overall team performance.
And how do you think the competitors in the league and everything will be?
Our league, we have a very solid league for wrestling. Jackson Western's very good at wrestling. Mason's very good. They've won 3 state championships in the last 13 years.
Yeah.
Eaton Rapids, of course, is always good. They've won 5 or 6 or maybe more state championships in the last 30 or 40 years. Jackson Northwest has a strong team. Really, every team, Jackson Lumen Christie, every team has a strong lineup and a strong team. I think last year, every duel, whether we won or lost, came down to really 1 or 2 matches. Mm-hmm. It was very close either way. I think we won. I think we lost 3 conference matches. I think we won 3, and all of them were close.
And you talk about the matches, and those are really school-to-school competitions. But when you do tournaments and things, weekends and other opportune times that young people are involved, how do you have a young person involved in wrestling be successful in the tournament kind of structure?
Well, now at least half to three quarters of our tournaments are team tournaments. We go up as a team versus other teams, and you do that five times throughout a day.
Yeah.
By the end of the day, the kids are completely worn out because they've wrestled five matches, and they're, and me as a coach, I'm worn out because I've yelled through five whole matches. That's,
yeah.
And there's 14 matches per match, so that's a lot of matches. Individually, we have some, and the younger kids, they honestly struggle with the individual ones because usually the kids are seeded, kind of like a basketball tournament, like the NCAA, they have one, seeds 1 through 8. And if you're an unseeded kid, sometimes you get paired up against that 1 seed or the 2 seed, and seldomly an upset will happen, but kind of like NCAA or March Madness, that's not very often.
Yeah.
Then the older kids usually get a higher 2 or 3 or even a 1 seed. But the younger kids, they learn from it, and they know their time's coming, and occasionally I'll have a freshman that he's that caliber where he is a 1 or a 2 seed.
And with that tournament schedule, as well as the competitions, as well as practice, it's a pretty demanding sport on the mat. But what do you demand from students in school as well?
Well, they have to definitely maintain their eligibility. They have to pass their classes. They have to maintain a 2.0 GPA.
Mm-hmm.
I check with their teachers regularly. I check their attendance daily to make sure they're in their classes. If teachers ask me if can so-and-so stay after and work on a quiz, the answer is always yes. So I'm definitely always working with teachers to keep the kids on their best behavior in school and keep their grades up the best I can.
And the young people want to wrestle, who are, so they want to do anything they have to do to be able to have access to the sport.
They do, and it's a sport where if you're not there, someone's going to start over you. There's not 5 people on the floor and you're going to get rotated in. It's we're wrestling this team, and either one person's going to wrestle this weight. There's no rotating halfway through the match. There's no subs.
Yeah. It's a very competitive sport, especially when you have a lot of people who want to be on the mat, internally within teams.
Yeah. For us, for example, this year at our 130 weight class, we're going to have some good kids that aren't going to be on the mat very often for us.
Yeah. And so you as a coach deal with that.
It's tough.
Yeah.
This wouldn't be my first. I mean, this would be my most extreme example. I mean, this year I'm not looking forward to this one to two weight classes where they're all going to be bunched, but I'll have to figure out a way to... I mean, I try to wrestle it. I try to get everybody in as much as possible.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not always, if we're wrestling Eaton Rapids in a dual meet, one person will wrestle, then we'll have some JV matches, and
yeah.
I try to get people the experience that I know they're going to need for the future. I mean, they're all young, they're sophomores, and they'll be back again for the next 2 years, so I want them to keep their confidence up, and also I want to have the best team as possible, too.
And really, you need to have the match competition and tournament competition to improve. So the more you're out on the mat, the better young people get.
Yeah, definitely. The more matches you wrestle, it's the better you'll be. Kind of like driving a car. The more you drive, the better you'll be at it.
Yeah.
If you can only practice so much and you're just tired of practice, you want to actually have a match to have a reason to practice.
Yeah.
Because practice is very demanding.
Well, so what do you want from parents who might have kids involved in your program?
Our parents have been very good in the past. They organize food tables for every Saturday. I do absolutely nothing for it. They call each other and they have a list and they organize who's bringing what, and they're at the same. I see the same parents at every Wednesday and every Saturday, and we have a pretty good following. It seems to be that every parent of all the 14 kids that are wrestling on that Saturday, they're all there, and their siblings are there, and sometimes their grandparents are there, and their aunt and uncle or whoever.
And does wrestling, why does it, or maybe it certainly does within families, but it's not a sport like basketball or football that draws the same kind of attention, even though for football, you have a lot of the players who might be engaged in the team. How do you promote the sport of wrestling?
I think it is a growing sport, to be honest with you. I think it is growing around the country. I know there's a lot of talk this last summer of it getting removed from the Olympics.
Yeah.
It caused a huge uproar. And that kind of seemed like it made wrestling bigger.
And that Olympic competition is an important example for young people to see.
Yeah, definitely. And, I mean, people from all over. I mean, actors like Billy Baldwin, for example, is huge into keeping wrestling in the Olympics. I don't know, much smaller scale like we're in.
Sure.
I talk to kids about it. I see a lot of freshmen in classes. I teach high school here, and I have a lot of freshmen, and I try to encourage freshmen that I think would like it to come out, and a lot of my athletes do the same thing. We just kind of encourage them. If they don't want to, they don't. When I have some kids that'll try it for a week or so, and say, oh, that's not for me, and I'll kind of let them go and say, okay, thanks for trying. I'm glad you came.
It's not a sport for everyone, is it?
Definitely not. No.
Yeah.
You have to be willing to give your Saturdays up. I mean, I'm gone on 6:30 a.m. on a Saturday, and I get home around 5:30 or 7 p.m., and same with the wrestlers. I mean, they're gone all day Saturday, so their weekends are shot. They get Sunday, and usually they're sore and their body's hurt, and they just wrestled 5 matches the day before. And
so what do you do about the issue of injuries? You really have to be careful in wrestling, don't you?
Yeah, we haven't been, I mean, knock on wood, we haven't had too many severe injuries. I mean, you get kids that get bumps and bruises, kind of like any sport. I mean, you'll get your occasional bad injury, but really we've been pretty fortunate that we haven't had anything major since I've been here.
And so what are the common injuries you have to be careful of?
Sore shoulders.
Yeah, sore shoulders.
Stressed muscles. Sore shoulders, yeah. Sore knees, necks, a lot of stiff necks.
And so what do you do as a coach?
I try to keep kids stretching as much as possible. They have to work with our trainer for a day or two and sit out or go light in practice. They do that. I try to keep them practicing, but I know they have some things that sometimes I just have to step back and tell them, okay, sit out for a day or two.
Yeah.
It's really the same with colds. Actually, cold and flus hit us worse than injuries do.
Really? Talk about that.
Because you have such, I mean, our whole kids practice with each other, and someone's sick and they're wrestling, so they're breathing all over, and they get their sweat on each other, and then they go to someone else and someone else, and before you know it, half the kids on the team have a cold or a flu, or the same thing with that. I kind of have to just know when to say, okay, I want you to sit out today.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to get better at wrestling. You're going to make everybody else worse.
And it happens even in competition with teams, right?
It does, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, you're in such close contact with other competitors, you really have to be careful about illness.
Yeah. We'll go and wrestle on a Wednesday. The next day we'll be back and 3 kids will be sick.
Yeah. And you kind of have to rely on other coaches to monitor that at schools.
Definitely.
So, as wrestling sort of progresses over time, and you've got a lot of committed young people engaged in it, do you find that it's a reason for young people to stay in school?
I think it's definitely something for kids to look forward to. I mean, obviously, I think kids should stay in school no matter what.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, sports in general, I think, is something for kids to look forward to after school, after when the day's over. They can go to practice, they can hang out with their friends at practice, they can play on a team or in a game with their classmates.
So what are wrestlers like? Tell people who don't have
I've had valedictorians for wrestlers. I've had kids that have a hard time staying eligible for wrestlers and everything in between.
Yeah.
I've had kids that are crazy about hunting. That's all they want to do. They want to go practice and they want to go hunting and trap. I have kids that play the piano extremely well. I have a kid right now who works for Boeing. He went to U of M for an engineering degree, and I worked for Boeing out in Seattle.
Wow.
And everything in between.
And so you've been a teacher for a long time.
It's my 10th year, yeah.
10th year teaching. And so what do you find, how have young people evolved and changed in the time that you've been teaching?
Really, I don't see much of a difference. I mean, I started here in 2004. Obviously, some things were different. In 2004, it was cell phones were just coming out. Everybody was starting to get a cell phone. And then it was iPods. And then it's iPads. And I mean, besides technology, really, students, I think, have really stayed the same.
Yeah. Are they good communicators, do you find? Can they tell you if something's wrong or right? Or
some. I mean, your typical 15-year-old boy is not going to tell you everything. Sometimes his parents have to relay the messages to you. But if you ask kids, they'll usually communicate. But what I find, even in high school, I can't just assume that a kid's going to communicate something with me. I would like to think that, but it's not usually the case.
And so talk about what you teach.
I teach phys ed and I teach wood shop. I teach, usually in phys ed, I teach weightlifting classes. I also teach some lifetime sports occasionally, but mainly weightlifting classes. And I also teach wood shop.
And so do you give young people some tips about weightlifting? Because their bodies are changing incredibly in this time that they might want to spend a lot of time weightlifting, and young people do.
Yeah, we go over different routines that they could do in the gym. Say they get a membership at Alive 5 years from now, or at their home if they get a set of dumbbells. We go over everybody, muscle, and I try to have them leaving the class with at least 5 to 10 exercises they could do per body and muscle outside of high school.
And so as a coach and a teacher, you talk a lot about training and competing. I would imagine that nutrition is probably something that's often overlooked. Young people don't think a lot about it.
Definitely. I mean, some young people, I mean, their families, eating healthy is expensive.
Yeah.
My family, we eat healthy. It's expensive. I know how much it costs to buy fresh produce.
Yeah.
So I know some of our families and our kids can't afford it. They eat meals out of boxes 5 days a week.
Yeah. And it not only does it cost money, but it also takes time
it
and
does,
thought.
Definitely, yeah. You have to clean the vegetables. You have to prepare the vegetables or the meat or if you're having fresh chicken or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. It takes time and it does take money.
But it's critical in being a competitive athlete.
Yeah, definitely. That's why your major college programs, they have catered meals and they go out to... They don't eat the same cafeteria food as everybody else for every meal.
Yeah.
They get some fresh stuff.
Well, Bill, it's been wonderful to talk to you. Good luck in the upcoming year. I'm sure that you'll be successful, and we look for Charlotte to be competitive and have a great wrestling team. So good luck to you.
Thank you.
I'm Bob Colt, and we'll continue our conversations in Charlotte Public Schools.